wishing you all a very happy new year. And regardless of what's going to happen going forward, let's, from this committee, do what we're supposed to be doing, and doing what's best for Northern Ireland, and cracking on and getting moving on. And without any further ado, can I declare the meeting open to the public? Again, remind members that your tablet devices and phones to be switched off. Remind members of their obligation to declare any relevant financial or other interests related in today's business. Inform the members of the public gallery that they can use their mobile devices as long as they're put on silent and turn to aeroplane mode. I think it's quite important we're talking about 3G and 4G and maybe 5G today as well. And these facilities should not be permitted, and it's not permitted to take photographs or recordings in the meeting. The meeting will be on camera. Item one, apologies. The only apologies we've received is from the chair.
Sir, we also think we have apologies from Alex Maskey and Keith Archibald as well.
But we haven't actually received those.
Not technically, but I check back for emails and texts once I turn my devices back on again. Just
and to... we're expecting Tom, and we're expecting...
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Item two, refer to the minutes of the draft minutes of the meeting held on the 14th of December at page 5 in your pack. Members, are you content the minutes are an accurate record of the meeting?
Content.
Great.
Content. Agreed.
Thank you.
Happy New Year, Gordon.
Happy New Year, Stan.
Yep. Moving to agenda item 3, declaration of interests. I need to remind you that under Standing Order 69, brackets 4, for taking part in any proceedings of the Assembly or its committee, a member must declare any interest, financial or otherwise, which is relevant to the debate or proceedings, where such interest is held by the members or an immediate relative. As this is the first meeting of 2017, it is a timely point to remind members to declare any interests held by them or which are relevant to the work of the committee. Any comments?
No.
Okay, moving on to item 4, chairperson's business, invitations from Tourism NI. There's been an invitation to attend the Northern Ireland Food and Drink closing banquet this evening at the Ulster Museum. Unfortunately, the chairperson is unavailable, but fortunately, I have been able to take his place this evening.
If anyone else can attend, there may still be an opportunity.
Well, does anybody else wish to attend?
Unfortunately, I'm otherwise engaged.
Yeah. Moving on, next one from correspondence. Correspondence from Endeavour Limited. Inform members at page 14 is a request from Endeavour Ireland Limited for an informal meeting to detail how the ARC 21 project can benefit the economy of Northern Ireland. I would like the sort of members' agreement for the, either the chairperson or myself to meet informally with Endeavour Limited. The chairperson is not available. I would like another member of the committee to join me in that discussions, because obviously with ARC 21 being in my constituency, I have particular views on that. So if anybody would be willing to join me in that.
Chair, what we'll do is we'll organise an informal, and then we put the date out and see which members are going to be available for that.
Okay, thank you. Moving on to launch of Advice NI Business Debtline Report. Point 4.3, inform members at page 15 is a request from the committee to co-host with the chairperson of the Committee for Communities the launch of NI Advice NI on its first ever report on the business deadline or business debtline service. There's a copy of the Advice NI training brochure. It's also available in the committee offices. And would the committee would be happy for us to co-sponsor this event?
Great.
Yep. Great.
Yep.
Thank you. We've got an invitation from ASPA UK, a request for either myself or the chairperson to address a lunchtime gallery reception on Thursday, the 19th of January in the Long Gallery. Since the chairperson is unable to attend, would you be happy for me to chair that?
Great.
Thank you. Right.
They are here.
Yeah.
Greg is just bringing them in. There we go.
Come on, Clive. John. Morning, gentlemen. And a happy new year to you.
And to you, thank you.
Just a bit happy new year. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the first session the committee has had with Ofcom. And Ofcom will be covering a range of issues, including broadband universal service application, digital communications review, and mobile phone network coverage. And hopefully you'll mention something about 4G and 5G and where that's going to as well. Okay? The floor is yours.
Andy, thank you very much. Deputy Chair, Clark, members, happy new year to you again, and thank you very much for the chance to come and talk to you. Members hopefully have the briefing note, which I hope is of some interest, and just by way of introduction, before we seek your thoughts, I thought it would be helpful just to make a few introductory comments to highlight three issues in particular from the briefing note. Firstly, the Digital Communications Review, which is a 10-year review Ofcom is undertaking of the UK's telecoms infrastructure. And a major part of that is proposed reforms to Openreach, which is BT's networks division. And the relevance for Northern Ireland for that is that Openreach has historically not existed in Northern Ireland. Instead, that service has been provided by BT's own Northern Ireland Networks division. So there's a question there as to whether that continues or whether we make changes there. Second issue then, and another part of the Digital Comms Review, is the Universal Service Obligation for Broadband. And this is a UK government initiative designed to give everybody a legal right to a minimum broadband speed, most likely to begin at 10 megabits per second. Ofcom's role in that is to provide technical advice to the UK government, which we have done by means of a report that we published in December, which is available online. And that report estimated the costs of rolling out universal broadband, and the implications for Northern Ireland are included in that. And if you were to start today to do that, to reach everybody with 10 megabits, it would cost you around about £40 million. If you were to reach everybody with 30 megabits, it would cost you closer to £100 million. Underpinning that analysis was the third issue I want to talk about, the Connected Nations Report for Northern Ireland. Mm-hmm. A look at the state of our infrastructure, both from broadband but also from mobile, and I know mobile coverage is an issue the members are particularly interested in. We've seen big improvements in mobile coverage, particularly in 4G in the last year, but we appreciate there is a lot more to be done. We're very happy to take questions on any of those topics, or indeed any aspect of Ofcom's regulatory responsibilities, whatever they may be. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. We'll just sort of kick off and ask a couple of sort of broader perspective points. One of the most significant issues we're having at the moment is concerns that we're receiving from a lot of our constituents and also across from the lots of the business community about the very poor standard of fibre going directly to the home or fibre going directly to the business. And one of the issues that we have been seeing, particularly in rollout in rural Scotland and also sort of rollouts we've seen in the Republic of Ireland, and obviously with their push towards 30 megabits per second and their push to do that as well, is the use of existing infrastructure to make that happen. And one of the things I would like was your observations on what discussions has been happening with the monopoly about what they're doing about opening up sort of links to use either their own sort of infrastructure to be able to bring in competition to that as well, or what can we see as the process of actually getting fibre directly to the sort of the house or the business, which is obviously the way ahead we need to go to, which is one of the concerns we've had raised. But please.
Okay, I'll maybe begin and make a point just about the Scotland and Republic of Ireland issues you mentioned and the 30 meg targets. It's worth just noting that in the report on the Universal Service Obligation plans for government, we included the implications of having a 30 meg target, albeit that 10 meg is probably what we would regard as being the current level for decent broadband, if you like. But we felt it was very important that we included a 30 meg standard because so many people who responded to the consultation were interested in 30 meg. We're aware of what's happening in Scotland. We're aware of the National Broadband Plan in the Republic of Ireland as well. So that's the context of that.
Yes. So if I respond in terms of what the overall Digital Communications Review strategy is trying to, how the levers we're trying to pull to actually help secure that, I think it's important to start with. Our starting point, of course, is what's the experience of fixed broadband and mobile broadband for consumers and businesses. We're not particularly hung up on a particular technology, but the reality is that if you want better broadband, it is more fibre. It's not necessarily fibre all the way to the premise. There is more than one way technologically to skin a cat, and we don't really mind. What we want is a high quality of service in terms of speed, a reliable service that doesn't drop out at inappropriate times, especially for businesses, and something which doesn't have high fault rates. That's the sort of aspiration and aim that we have. And the levers that we're looking to pull to get there, I think, are several-fold. The first is we are actively working on a regulatory remedy to give access to BT's ducts and poles. And that is designed and enabled to allow third parties to utilise that infrastructure to build fibre at a lower cost than otherwise might be the case. Now, that won't apply to all parts of the UK. It won't apply in terms of there won't always be ducts and poles that are appropriate for use. It might be that actually sometimes companies like Virgin, who is extending its footprint in Northern Ireland, choose to build themselves the full infrastructure. They'd just rather own the whole thing rather than be reliant. But we are trying to put that within the sphere and opportunity of people who want to build more fibre networks. The second point is we also then want to provide the commercial incentive to do that. And from a regulatory perspective, we do that by ensuring regulated prices for today's broadband services don't disincentivise investment. What I mean by that is if we price wholesale access too low, companies who buy access to BT's network don't see quite the same compelling case to build their own. If you price too high, consumers are footing a bill. We don't want that. There's a halfway house, trying to find a sweet spot where you're incentivising people to build and operate their own network rather than piggybacking on BT's, so that you're not just reliant upon BT making the decision about when and how to invest. The next element of our strategy is...
Just interject there a bit, Clive. Of course. One of the issues that's happened, particularly in the Republic of Ireland, and I think in the west coast of Scotland, has been an obligation or discussions with other people who own infrastructure, particularly electricity companies. Has there been any sort of thought process that you've been going through to be able to engage directly with the likes of NIE,
yes,
who have many, both have ducts and poles? And one of the things that's happened in the Republic of Ireland is obviously, let me get this right, AIR and AIR Grid have been forced to get together, and also ESB have been forced to get together to use the sort of the what they see as the strategic national infrastructure.
So at the moment, actually, it's a very good point. There is a second piece to the infrastructure access, the passive access element, which is something which came from the European Commission. It was originally called the Cost Reduction Directive. It has since changed its name, and I can never keep tabs. But it is actually a piece of regulation that allows operators to request access to any infrastructure, any wayleaves, for the deployment of what is defined as fast broadband services. That will include all of the water utilities and the electricity utilities. It is done on request, so it's for the communication providers to go to those parties. If there is a dispute around that access, Ofcom is the dispute resolution body. And we have recently published guidelines as how we would resolve disputes. But in terms of that enabling piece of legislation, then really the ball at the moment is in the court of those people who want to build the networks to go then to these alternative infrastructure owners to request access. I would hope they can come to commercial agreement. If they can't, that's where Ofcom would step in order to broker that access. And that is a relatively new piece of legislation. It covers, as I say, actually not just the other utilities, it also covers telecoms operators who are not BT. It includes Virgin, it will include other telecoms operators who have physical infrastructure as well.
Okay, thank you. Thanks for that, Clive.
So moving back to the strategy, second part of the strategy is around, as Jonathan mentioned, Openreach, where we want to make Openreach more responsive to its customers. So this is around promoting the incentives on BT to deploy fibre when there's a commercial case, and to ensuring that BT, Openreach, listens to its customers, Sky, TalkTalk, Vodafone, if they have a desire and case for investment in fibre themselves, or a desire and case to effectively become an anchor tenant on BT's network, Openreach's network, to then support the deployment of fibre. And that is where we're trying to create an independent strategic decision-making body within Openreach to help that, again, cross-industry debate about when is the right time to take the big step, and it is a big step to fibre to the premise, to make that investment. And then I think the last point I'd note around our strategy is that that's great, I think, where commercial incentives work. The reality is there are big parts of the country across the UK, and specifically in the nations where typically more rural, more sparsely populated areas, the commercial case is unlikely to work, especially for fibre to the premise, but also actually for just faster broadband speeds with more fibre. And that is, as Jonathan say, where the universal service obligation may kick in combination with the UK government and the Northern Ireland executives' actions around public intervention and public funding. And that is, as Jonathan say, why we included an option for a universal service of 30 megabits per second downstream and 6 megabits per second upstream. I'll be clear, it's not necessarily fibre to the premise for those people who want 1 gigabit to their business or their home. That's not there.
Yeah.
But it is saying if actually the policymakers want to have a slightly further reaching ambition, and to be clear, it would be slightly further reaching, and it is testing the bounds of what a universal service would be allowed to offer under the current European Commission guidelines. That is something we think is worthwhile costing so people can have that debate. And we absolutely heard from stakeholders across the UK, but especially in more rural areas, where they were saying, and that includes SMEs and residential, we need better broadband where we are.
Yeah, someone else. Okay, thank you. Sinead?
Yes, thank you, Chair. Thank you for that. The understanding that exists between companies and Openreach are using this infrastructure, if you like, nobody really wants an agenda that's going to encourage building poles up everywhere. So I think that really needs to be tied down. From my understanding, it hasn't really fully embedded the understanding between companies and the use of other infrastructure in terms of NIE, for example, and I think that's something I would like to put on record and say that should be refined. But as an elected representative, I come at this from a very consumer, customer-facing angle, and no doubt you'll be aware that through our constituency offices we routinely hear that broadband's just not accessible, or people are being told it's not in your area, or there's no box near to your premises, and they stand at the front door and point to a box and say, yes it is, but it's not coming to my house. And I think it's a very complex to understand why a box could sit, you know, outside your front door and you're told that it's not accessible to you. And also, I'm not sure what role you have in terms of the advertising of the product that a consumer chooses to take on board. So there seems to be still a lot of misleading information in the advertising world in terms of customers are signing up to an obligation for perhaps 12-month or 24-month contract with these very vast promises and bold headlines of what they can expect. And the reality turns out to be something very different. And I would be interested to know if you have a role in that.
Of course. So two questions. So the first is, and I think you're absolutely right in the articulation, we had a letter just before Christmas of a gentleman in a very similar position, where there is a village which half of the village is connected to the cabinet in the village and the other half of the village is connected to a cabinet in the adjacent village. And that is just the way the network had been built for voice telephony. And it worked perfectly well for voice telephony, and come broadband, it doesn't work particularly well at all. That is a real challenge, I think, and until there is a policy, a universal service type policy which enables people to make a request, a right to request broadband to their location, I think the only thing we can do is almost communicate that on a case-by-case basis, because there's no way of being able to articulate, I think, to people in different circumstances, why is it when you can see a cabinet you're not actually able to access that cabinet? And the reality is, there's a very good reason they could, and it would cost tens of thousands of pounds to do that. And at the moment, no one is under any obligation to do that. The consumer is unlikely to want to pay that. Indeed, I think this individual had actually got, as part of their community, they'd got BT to what would it cost? And the cost was prohibitively expensive, even as a community gathering together to try and make that happen. So I think our role is really to try and communicate to people a few things. One is, clearly, what is the speed that you can get today? And ideally, insofar as we can gather the information and publish the information, what can you reasonably expect in a reasonable time frame? So, for example, with the public procurement and the public initiatives to invest, what does that mean for when you might get broadband enhancements? One of the biggest frustrations we hear is people say, I'm told it is, I know I don't have it now, I know it is coming, no one can tell me when it is coming. You just tell me when, and I might be a little bit happier. And that, I think, we can help address. I think the other thing is actually to answer those questions as they arise and to provide, for example, each of yourselves and your offices the ability to answer those questions as to why are people in these circumstances. It doesn't fix the circumstance, but it helps at least mitigate people not knowing why it does frustrate them. To your second question on advertiser speed, so we have been working with the ASA around the advertising of services, and that includes, I think, going forwards, the ASA is going to focus on the use of the term fibre. What actually is fibre? What is speed? I think our bigger role is supporting the ASA in that on the advertising front. It's actually making clear to consumers by publishing information and making that information available on an individual premises basis, what is the speed that you can actually get? What is the network which connects to your home actually capable of? And in our Connected Nations, this time, for the first time, we have published premise-level information, and that will be accompanied by applications and maps available online, so not just a dry document where people can actually put their postcode in and discover what the network that is connected to their home is capable of delivering. And again, that is something which I think is useful for them to understand as they make decisions around what is available to them. It doesn't fix the advertising problem if people miss out.
Can I ask, when you say what is available to them,
yes,
is that a guarantee that, or is that a maximum that they could expect to get?
It is an estimate of what their line would actually deliver.
Okay.
So, it is a for real number,
yeah,
but it is a for real number when the network is working well. So there will always be times when at busy times of the Friday evening, it might go down in speed, but it's absolutely saying your line can do 30 megabits per second. It mm-hmm. cannot do 80.
Okay, so if you're consistently getting less than that, then you're not being delivered the
correct.
Product.
Mm-hmm. Exactly, okay. And that again enables people to say, well, hang on, what's going on? There's another thing around the activity that we have is around communicating to people that the end-to-end internet experience is the other thing they need to bear in mind. So your access network might work very well, your in-home wiring might be the problem, your Wi-Fi network might be the problem. And we released an application last year which allows you to test whether your Wi-Fi network is working as well as it could and to identify issues within your Wi-Fi network. There's a set of things where we're providing consumer guides to say, if not the access network, the physical connection, where else can you look? What else might be going on? And we're going to continue to do that, I think, going forward. In ways, our challenge is ways that make it relevant to individuals. We will write reports, and you will read our reports, and you will find them very interesting. Consumers do not read our reports. Mm. They are far too dry for most consumers. We need to make it relevant to them, and that's, I think, our big challenge going forward.
Thank you.
Sorry, just to add very briefly, I would also just point out that Ofcom's office in Northern Ireland is at your disposal. If you have constituency questions, we are very happy to try and help find out the information for you in terms of the history of why a particular set of premises has or does not have broadband or mobile coverage, and we'll do our best to try and get the answer for you.
Yeah, and I'll just ask the clerk there, but thank you very much indeed for that particular information. But I think as soon as those maps are available, mm-hmm. that detail is available, if the committee could have those.
Of course.
And we'll ensure that goes out as quickly as possible. Mervyn?
Thank you, Vice Chair, and Jonathan and Clive, thanks. Also, thanks for the help that you've been when we've contacted you and the work that you've done. It's much appreciated. Do we not run the risk, Jonathan, of having the same situation in broadband as we have in energy? That it suits those who are the providers to make it overly complicated. And not being the brightest bulb in the box, I have to say, I see it as in a very simplistic way. They provide us, you pay them, they provide a service. But if the providers are not guaranteed they're going to get enough customers, they make all complicated rules and regulations, and they use the regulator, and they use the government, and unless the government give them a huge amount of money, they will not do A, B and C. Because how many times I've had in my own constituency a cabinet outside the door, a person can see it, but they can't get the speed. And it is simply because there is not enough of customers who will ensure that the financial or the business model that the provider has is financially sound. And how do we break that cycle? And because it keeps going round and round, and Clive's absolutely right, you know, the average person, including ourselves, cannot sometimes get beyond the jargon, but it is not as complicated, mm-hmm. But it is made complicated because that suits the purpose of the providers.
I think Sinead made the point about coming at this from a consumer perspective, and actually that is, we like to think, the perspective that Ofcom is coming at it from as well. And Clive has mentioned things like the ASA from an advertising and from a retail perspective. There are measures there designed to try and help protect consumers in terms of the advertising standards rules for broadband, which have changed recently. So you have a one-off whole price presented rather than the small print, mm-hmm. adding additional line rental and so on. We also introduced a code of practice a number of years ago for broadband speed, so that now you have to be told when you purchase a broadband product what speed you can expect, and if you do not get that, then you have the right to exit that contract, and that's been introduced also for SMEs as well. So there are some retail consumer protections in place. I think from a network perspective, and Clive will want to say more about this, I think the USO, as it is proposed, has the potential to be the game changer in terms of the situation you described, Mervyn, where a resident simply cannot get a particular broadband speed, regardless of how far or close they may be from the cabinet. To have that enshrined in legislation as a legal right to request a speed of a particular level, obviously that whole process, that the decision making of what the ESO practically looks like is one for the UK government. Our job, as Clive explained, is to provide the technical advice, which we have done, and I think we have presented a very broad suite of options and scenarios, so the government has every opportunity to make a really informed decision.
Yeah, I mean, if I add to that, so I think there are probably three things I'd add. The first, and this absolutely applies in denser urban areas I'm conscious of, is we are still keen to promote competition. It is, I think, the risk of BT having someone come along and eat its lunch that will drive BT to do stuff. It is not necessarily consumers voicing concerns. Yeah. A monopolist, at its worst, will always be able to not listen to consumers. The fact that Virgin across the UK is extending its footprint is actually one of the biggest challenges to BT to raise its game. And in my experience, actually, you know, going back 10 years, once BT realises it can do something, it can actually go further even necessarily than the Virgin competition extends to. Once they demonstrate to themselves that it's not quite so hard to build a new network or to operate a new network, once you have the Openreach engineering force geared up, skilled up and out there delivering it, they can go a bit further. That, I think, is key, and that's where we want to promote the ability for companies like TalkTalk and Sky and Vodafone and Virgin, and, to be fair, smaller operators across the United Kingdom, to be able to come in and say, I can do this if you're not going to. That doesn't work in rural areas. I think in the rural areas, the USO is absolutely the situation. One part of our advice to UK government, actually, around how a USO would work, critical, was around demand aggregation. It was around having communities able to voice their interest in, desire for, need for a higher quality broadband services, such that demand was clearer to the universal service provider. I think without that, and there is increasing experience of how that can work through a range of public interventions, it's quite difficult to deliver public interventions. And finally, the other thing I'd note is that even UK government is also looking at trying to extend and expand the expertise and learnings of local areas into how they made fibre investment happen in their local area. And Treasury has just released a consultation where they're seeking input on almost the best-in-class experiences of local authorities, councils, municipalities. What have you done in your local area that actually sort of triggered and got fibre going, and how far can they get that information shared? Now, that's going back, again, back to my time 10 years ago, where we had regional development agencies doing something very similar. I think it's a wonderful idea. There are some councils out there who are massively proactive about leveraging their own infrastructure, about using their own procurement to use as an anchor tenant, around a whole set of things. And there are some actual councils, I think, who are slightly further behind, who don't know what to do, or actually sometimes are relatively obstructive around planning rules and regulations. That best of breed, what you can do as a local authority, as a local body, I think is also really useful to get out there, because people can learn from each other.
Thank you. Gordon.
Thanks, Chair, and thanks, gentlemen. Good to see you again, Jonathan and Clay. There's been a huge investment in various programmes over the years. Jonathan, you obviously will be aware of it. As I understand, done mainly through BT. BT have been the main contractor for installation of broadband. And we're on to super fast broadband now, so how do you see it in relation to value for money in your assessment? Has it been and proved to be real value for money for Northern Ireland, for the customer out there?
In terms of the level of the investment, I think, I was just doing some sums there, I think we're in excess of about 90 million. To date, in three phases, around just over 50 for the first initial fibre rollout, and then two subsequent schemes, one of which is still on, is ongoing, 23 million and 17 million. I should preface this actually by saying that Ofcom has no role in terms of oversight or auditing of what previously DETI and now DfE have been doing in terms of value for money, but I think it is well recognised that Northern Ireland was in the vanguard of a fibre to the cabinet rollout, which is now being replicated and is still being replicated by Broadband Delivery UK, primarily in Great Britain now. So I think it put Northern Ireland way out in front whenever this initial rollout began. And I think what we have seen since is actually Northern Ireland has been sort of the first to try and surmount some of the obstacles there have been. So we have a particular challenge in Northern Ireland because our population is particularly well spread out, and Mervyn has cited examples and other members have cited examples where some people who seem to be quite close to the cabinet don't seem to be able to get a good speed. So we've been the first nation of the UK, I think, to try and address that particular problem, and it's slightly more acute in Northern Ireland than elsewhere. Difficult for us to make any sort of judgment on the value of that, but if you look at what we published in terms of our report to government in December on the USO, you can see that fibre to the cabinet is still likely to be the focus for USO, along with fibre to the premise and maybe other technologies as well. And it's interesting just to look at the costs, the cost implications for that for Northern Ireland if you were to proceed with a USO, and how much it would cost. And we would undoubtedly benefit from the work that DETI and DfE have done over the last 5 to 6 years.
In the Cyber Mass Broadband, how is it progressing in the latest phase? Are you aware of how it's progressing?
Well, in our Connected Nations report, we've reported that super fast broadband at 30 megabits, as we would define it, is now available to 83% of premises, and that's up from 77% last year. So there has been a steady increase. We are more or less on a par with the rest of the UK in terms of the availability of super fast broadband. And when I say availability, I don't mean simply just being connected to a cabinet that has been fibred, but I mean actually being able to get a speed on your phone line in excess of 30 megabits. So Northern Ireland is certainly on a par with the rest of the UK for super fast at the moment.
But we still have the issues already being mentioned, and especially in rural areas. And if you go from here towards north down, you don't get very far up the hills there till you're on a mobile phone. It's likely to cut out before you get 2 miles from here. And there are various technologies available, you know, and we've been told that, but are those options really being used to their best effectiveness in trying to address issues like that?
Well, to start with, and mobile coverage in North Down is something we've discussed on many occasions.
Indeed.
Gordon, I'd love to be able to have a ubiquitous solution for you, but part of the thing that we can do is get better customer information out there as to what networks are available where, and part of the reason we do that is as an incentive to the operators to actually invest further. It's worth noting that before Christmas, our chief executive wrote to each of the UK mobile network chief executives to basically lay out a sort of a 100% coverage challenge, and recognising importantly that there are things that we as a regulator may need to do in order to assist that. It is not something we are just laying down at the foot of the operators and saying, off you go, let's have 100%. There are things that there is a role, that, very clear role that we have to play in terms of some regulatory levers that we can pull. But we want to work together with industry, and we've started that discussion to try and challenge them to get to that 100%. In terms of other technologies, I suspect you're talking about broadband in terms of things like satellite and fixed wireless. Both of which have played a role in the past in providing coverage and may well, certainly in terms of fixed wireless, may provide a sort of an alternative technology under USO if the UK government decided to go down that particular road, where for the very, very, very hardest to reach properties. But it looks certainly that fibre to the cabinet, fibre to the premise are going to be the main game.
Yeah. Just on the mass that we talked about many years ago, we used to argue with you when you came to the council some years ago. Is the sharing of mass something we were always a bit sceptical? Is that openly promoted now, and is that openly available, or is there still this reluctance? After all, they're all competitors. So does it really exist, the sharing of mass facilities?
Well, they're competitors on the high street. They're not necessarily competitors when it comes to the infrastructure. And in fact, what you're seeing increasingly is effectively two networks developing, O2 and Vodafone sharing, and E and 3. So yes, sharing in mast infrastructure is very much in their interest because it removes a fairly significant cost for them as a business. And while in my previous life I would have come to various councils to extol the virtues of rolling out mobile phone networks, it was a much more individual process at that stage, and it was much more every network for themselves. And that has changed dramatically over the last 15 years, and now the networks are well established. They're looking to cut costs in their infrastructure.
Yes, I mean, I think my experience is from a, you know, it's a cross UK, pan UK experience. There is a tension. There is a tension that they are competitors, and there are times when they have disputes and disagreements, and they're not necessarily the happiest with each other. also, there are times when, regardless of that, they can see the commercial requirement and necessity of doing this. And it's not quite the same thing, but the example I would give is Virgin Media has recently announced that it's signed a new deal for its MVNO access arrangement with EE, which is owned by BT. At the point of the merger, Virgin was deeply unhappy about the idea of its MVNO provider being BT, its major competitor. The two of them have managed to get over that. There is still a competitive tension between them. I think that will absolutely be true in mobile networks, not least because across the UK, as you move towards 4G enhancements and ultimately 5G, the vision, insofar as people can see it, is going to be not tens of thousands of masts, but hundreds of thousands of small masts. Mm-hmm. You won't be able to do that unless you are sharing infrastructure in an effective manner. And that will mean that they'll have to get over those competitive differentials, differences, in order to be able to deliver what actually consumers are increasingly wanting. And whilst consumers don't understand the network economics and they don't understand the network dynamics, they don't understand where a Pico and Femto cell is. What they do understand is how frustrated they get when they're sitting in a room and they want to get 4G or 5G and it's not working. And if someone can offer them something better, including Wi-Fi, by the way, and you know, that is, again, the competitive driver for these people to get on and share. So I'm hopeful that that will continue. And we are, as Jonathan said, in Sharon sort of setting out the challenge, we're clear that, you know, as and when competition issues may arise in network sharing, we look at that from a consumer perspective and say, what's in the interest of consumers? And, you know, does this make sense? Is there a role, actually, for example, of a single mobile physical network in the most rural and remote areas of the United Kingdom? Would that unlock the ability to get it further out? And actually, do we need to take a little bit of a role of saying, well, why aren't we doing that? And can we promote it and facilitate it somehow? And it doesn't quite sit with the normal sort of competition thinking, but you're beyond that, because you are talking about the hardest to reach, be honest, 30% of the geographic landmass of the United Kingdom, and the hardest to reach 2% of the population. But if we're going to fix this, that's the sort of thinking that we need to engage with industry.
You mentioned there just about Virgin. What about Virgin in Northern Ireland? Are they intending to expand here and invest further?
Yes, they are. And I've had a number of conversations with Virgin locally, actually, and about very specific incidents where residents aren't able to get a service that they regard as decent from BT. And certainly we have, you know, lots of very interesting conversations with Virgin about their possibility of stepping in and rolling out a network, extending their existing footprint in areas where they see a bit of a competitive advantage.
They would have a fairly extensive cable facility in the Greater Belfast area, wouldn't they?
They pass about 30% of premises across Northern Ireland at the moment.
30%,
which is proportionately lower than other parts of the UK. So far, their rollout, as most people will know, has been limited to Greater Belfast and Derry, Londonderry, and that's really been it. So they're looking to not just increase those two existing footprints, but also look at provincial towns as well.
Good. Thanks very much, gentlemen. Thanks, Chair.
Thanks very much. Just a few final points. Ofcom has taken a very clear view on Openreach and BT and splitting them up and what they need to do. Mm-hmm. Of course, we don't have that situation in Northern Ireland. So I'd just like Ofcom NI's view on the current relationship between BT, NI and its various relationships, because one of the things that has been very clear and has been mentioned time and time again, particularly in GB, is the problems with Openreach and the relationship with BT. So bearing in mind Northern Ireland specific, I would like us to put on record some of Ofcom's perspective on that. And the second question is on sort of, and I was alluding to it early on, is about the issue about 5G. Mm-hmm. And one of the most significant things we need to do with 5G, with the microtransmitter network, is of course it all needs to be linked up to fibre and needs to be linked up to high capacity fibre. So we're beginning to see a wicked problem beginning to develop here. So again, your views on how we get to that point where we actually have the significant fibre network to make sure 5G works, because this is going beyond just trying to make get us to where we want to be now with the sort of the universal service obligation. But just those final points, gentlemen, please.
Yes, shall I start with that? So we're clear in our work in Openreach that we need to find a solution that benefits consumers and citizens and businesses across the entirety of the UK. And we do need to take into account that the starting position is different, as Jonathan said, for Northern Ireland today. We have spoken to stakeholders in Northern Ireland, and we have had a mixed message in terms of what the relationship is like with Northern Ireland Networks, who acts on behalf of Openreach within Northern Ireland. There are some issues and some concerns, specifically around the confusion that results from the branding and the presence that Openreach BT has in Northern Ireland vis-a-vis its competitors. At the same time, we've also heard that the quality of service, the operational experience, the way that the network is managed and run in Northern Ireland is very good compared to actually the rest of the UK, and indeed is delivering a better quality of service on certain metrics than the rest of the UK. And one of the things that the stakeholders are advocating is saying, please can you fix the things we'd like to fix, but whatever you do, do not break the fact that it's working reasonably well. So that is a difficult challenge. We are working through now what actually for the entirety of Openreach mean for Northern Ireland. And just to be clear, the goal we have is such that investment decisions taken by Openreach are done on a strategic basis and done in a way that considers the interests of all downstream customers of Openreach, so all of the communication providers who utilise Openreach's network. And that includes communication providers in Northern Ireland. I don't think that we want to slavishly say a single solution is necessary everywhere. What we need to say is, yes, if there's a differential solution, why would there be a differential solution? And does that differential solution still deliver the benefits that we are looking to achieve in terms of that strategic decision making? And that is what we're going through now. That might mean that we end up with an enhancement of the existing model with refinements, but the ability for strategic decision making to cascade down to Northern Ireland. It might be that the alternative is, no, what you need to do is make a break with the current model and actually implement what you do for the rest of UK within Northern Ireland as well. We're going through that process right now. I'm just conscious that I wouldn't say we're going to slavishly stick with the one size fits all. We're going to be very clear that whatever happens in Northern Ireland, it mustn't detrimental or risk leaving Northern Ireland behind. I absolutely do not want to break a model that seems to be working reasonably well on the ground today, and that would be a real shame if we were to throw the baby out with the bathwater. But we have to be conscious that a differential model, of course, both has to be justified, why does it differential, and you have to be confident that it can work in the long term. And by the way, in the long term, yeah, with these reviews come up once every 10 years, so you have to be very confident that what you do now is going to have legs and is going to last. And that is the specific, I would say, microcosm. It's a particularly big and difficult issue, actually, because of the differential starting point. But it is thinking about that in the context of everything else we're doing in Openreach. So I hope that answers your question. I don't yet know what our solution will be. I would
encourage you, and through the committee and so the members of the committee, I'll ask their view on actions for afterwards. But we would like to be kept fully informed as this goes forward, because as you're quite right, this is a decades sort of, and we need to get this one right.
Absolutely.
We'd be very happy to do that, Deputy Chair. And before Clive tells you all about 5G, I would just add that, yes, we've had 10 years' evidence of good, strong engineering performance compared to counterparts in Great Britain. But actually, the reforms we have in mind for Openreach are for the next 10 years. And I think where BT in Northern Ireland and Ofcom are in agreement is the current model needs enhanced in certain ways. So it is not going to be a question of maintaining what we have. We've had 10 years of good performance, but we've seen where there are areas for improvement, and that's what we're discussing, and we'd be very happy to keep you updated.
This is, as you can imagine, this is a particularly sensitive issue for all of us. Right.
Of course.
And 5G?
5G. So apologies, I'll offer my own personal view on 5G, if I may, but then come back to your question. So to be clear, and I'm sure actually the committee knows already, anyone who tells you they know what a 5G network or service is at the moment not quite being fully truthful. There are lots of visions, and the reality is no one knows. And the hype, to be fair, in the last 6 months has become slightly embarrassing when you actually have a little bit more insight into what people are talking about. But nevertheless, that is what happens, and it's fine. But I think, Chair, your question is absolutely right, is how does Ofcom enable the evolution of mobile networks, because that's what we are talking about. And the reality is it probably is going to embody more small cells and possibly some sort of ubiquitous Internet of Things type infrastructure. Those are two use cases which seem to have a lot of traction with people in industry and within vertical segments, and therefore is likely to, I think, take off. And you're absolutely right, the question is around the infrastructure and also the spectrum. So actually, I'd say that the things that we are doing are twofold. The first is enabling and preparing for spectrum to be available that will support these sorts of services. Definitely. We have the 2.3 and 3.4 gigahertz awards upcoming, and 3.4 gigahertz is the first tranche of spectrum that people in the industry believe could be used for a 5G or 5G-like service. So that is there. But we're looking further into the time future as well and saying what are the spectrum bands internationally are going to be for 5G, and also then which ones are available in the UK and how can we make those available going forward. So that's the first part. I think the second part is actually we need to ensure that, for example, planning regulations and rules and the ability to build more masts and everything else works. Now, we don't own that, but we are working closely with government at the moment around exactly making sure that things like the Electronic Communications Code is fit for purpose for exactly this sort of mass market network rollout. And lastly, the question of sort of the backhaul infrastructure, the stuff that connects all of this stuff. We're doing two parts here. The first is actually where there is still the potential, I think, for wireless to play a role in that, certainly in certain locations, and we are looking at fixed link spectrum that can be used for high-capacity wireless backhaul from more mobile base stations and cell sites. And so that is one element. But you're right, increasingly, if you have very high-capacity base stations, you need fibre, and you need fibre relatively close to it. And that then goes to this question around, do you need more ubiquitous fibre networks?
Yes, we're at the same point.
I think, actually, there is a potential, because at the same time, despite BT not yet having a plan or vision for fibre to the premise, they do have a vision for fibre going further and deeper into the infrastructure of the network. And I'm hopeful that actually a lot of you can piggyback on that. BT also has fibre products available today, which means you can build fibre. There's a product called Street Access, where actually they will build fibre to, for example, to a lamppost or to a telephone box or to some other local. So there are also some dedicated solutions rather than just piggybacking. But you're absolutely right, these two things start to converge as saying you want fibre closer to the premise, and by the way, at the same time, I would like a base station closer to the premise that's ideally offering higher capacity. And that is underlying our desire to try and see these networks expanded and enhanced. I would hope a good broadband USO is also complementary to that, not least because a good broadband USO will result in more fibre in certain locations. But it's a challenge for us to keep an eye on and to work with industry on as they develop their plans for what 5G is in future.
Okay. Gentlemen, thank you very much indeed, and thank you very much indeed for the evidence. Thank you. Okay.
Thank you very much.
Hey, John.
Thanks, Dan.
This one's going to be good for you, Peter, isn't it? Gentlemen, while we've still got a quorum, can we move on to item 6 of the agenda fairly quickly? This is a UK exit from the European Union. I would like to highlight to the members that the committee has received a range of information regarding UK exit from the EU, including a paper published just before Christmas setting out the Scottish Government's position on how it would like to negotiate the EU exit. Can I refer you to the papers, the Clark's memo on page 45, Scotland's place in Europe on page 59, which I would commend you to read, whether you agree with Brexit or not, or whatever the views are. It is actually a very well researched and it's actually a very well resourced document. There's quite a lot of interesting issues in it. Northern Ireland Food and Drinks Brexit Report on page 121, correspondence from Robert Walker on page 151. Vecinai's press release, page 153, and the Northern Ireland Assembly EU Matters newsletter, page 155. And I'm going to ask Peter here to summarise all that in a short time.
Chair, the memo pretty much does that. Now, I'll just take you through. The committee has had a vast amount of information on the UK exit from the EU, and we've been passing that to members as we've gone along. This just seemed to be a useful opportunity to try and draw some of that together and take a fairly light skip through just what the key issues that have been thrown up are. So if I just take each piece at a time, obviously there's some I won't refer to because time is not infinite. Scotland's place in the EU begins really with setting out Scotland's particular interests that are summarised as its economic interests. What they title the solidarity of nations coming together for the benefit of their citizens, I'm assuming that means for global issues, often you can get a better deal for people if you come together in a group. The particular instances they use are global crime or terrorism, where international agencies have tended to work a bit better in terms of people crossing borders and so on. They also highlight as an interest social protection, workers' rights, social rights, but also environmental and human rights. They talk about democratic interests, which in Scotland's case, obviously, they're referring to the fact that the majority of people there voted to remain within the EU, and also Scotland's interest, which is effectively being able to help shape policies and laws that will ultimately affect Scotland's economic and social development. They kind of look at three ways of achieving this maintenance of Scottish interests, which is essentially through the Brexit negotiations. So they want to influence those negotiations, making sure there's a strong Scottish voice in any process. Also, they've looked at differentiated options for Scotland, where there may be alternatives that can be explored for Scotland to have a slightly differentiated outcome from the exit from the EU. And also, perhaps one that's particularly relevant here is the expansion of the Scottish devolution settlement. With the repatriation of so many powers from the EU, the UK government will have to look at just exactly how that is parcelled out, and members will be acutely aware of the fact that, you know, for the last 40 years or so, there's a number of policy areas that have been largely set by the EU. Something, you know, an easy one to point to is something like agriculture, but you're also talking environmental issues. There are so many issues there that power will be repatriated, theoretically, to the UK, and it's how that is then developed. The Scottish paper puts forward a number of areas where they feel they will have to have increased or expanded devolutionary powers. The parallel is not direct with Northern Ireland, purely because the Northern Ireland devolution settlement is slightly fuller and incorporates a bit more than that of Scotland. But essentially, there's a good set of issues raised there that will allow members to kind of think about what exactly might have to happen once powers are repatriated and how that might need to be woven into the devolution settlement. That's Scotland's place in Europe summed up very quickly. I confess there's a lot more technical detail to it, but I'm not going to go through that because you're probably best reading that yourself and having a look at it and thinking about it. The other thing I reflected on in the memo is the letter that FM and DFM sent to the Prime Minister around Brexit. In that, there were five key issues for Northern Ireland, and the committee, when it had its strategy session in September, agreed that the first three are essentially within this committee's particular remit. That's the issue around Northern Ireland being the only part of the UK to share a land border with another EU member and how that will impact. The second, how Northern Ireland seeks to retain its competitiveness and remains attractive to foreign direct investment in any kind of Brexit process. Also, how we can maximise access to the European market as part of the Brexit negotiation as well. And particular issue, obviously, reflecting on the border, is those who commute across the border on a daily basis, either coming north or going south, for work, how that is sorted out as well as part of any settlement. The third one is energy, flagged up as a key issue. because the Northern Ireland's market is small and fairly isolated, the impact of Brexit could be disproportionate here, which brings in things that the committee has looked about previously, like the ISEM and so on, and how that is taken forward. Those are the three out of the five that were particularly relevant to this committee. Those are the ones that we had initially talked about particularly pursuing around our Brexit work stream. I'll move on to another document that the Deputy Chair referred to, was the Northern Ireland Food and Drink Association Brexit Challenges and Opportunities Report. This is one we put to committee just before the visit down to Dublin, particularly with reference to meeting with Board BIA, because it obviously it deals particularly with the agri-food industry. Also, it was something that was discussed extensively during the meetings with IBEC, IDA, CBI, Northern Ireland, down in Dublin, but also with the Joint Directors Committee on Jobs, Innovation and Enterprise, or Jobs, Enterprise and Innovation. It's a huge issue that the agri-food sector is underpinned by a lot of cross-border activity where things may be derived within Northern Ireland but processed in the south or vice versa. So there's a massive amount of linkage there, and the industry has flagged up particular issues around that. Essentially what their priorities boil down to are having those issues recognised, having a strong voice in any negotiations that are undertaken on Brexit, but also ensuring that the unique situation with the industry straddling both sides of the border is particularly respected. It's a very useful report, and it's included in the pack if members want to reflect on that. They look specifically at a number of issues around how Northern Ireland can modify its agri-food industry to create greater capacity, how it can target new and different markets, how it can address some of the systemic problems there are within the industry as well. Those are things that probably are best going to be addressed in any negotiation that goes forward on Brexit, but it's just to put them at the forefront of members' minds. Another key issue that they talk about is also the idea of having access to seasonal migrant labour. You'll all be aware, because most members have at least, you know, part of their constituency is fairly rural and does depend on farming. There's an awful lot of farming goes on with the use of seasonal workers coming in to harvest, gather or whatever. And the industry has highlighted this as a particular issue, being able to still have access to that pool, nearly always of Eastern European or Southeast European EU citizens. Without that, the industry would find it very difficult to maintain a lot of those particular sectors, because they are what's described as having full employment, i.e. they can't get local people to do the particular jobs. It's considered as a full employment sector. It's bizarre and it's technical, but that's how it tends to be described. And they therefore require the influx of migrant workers, who often will work their way around the island as a whole. And again, that brings into questions around the border. If I move on from that to the next one I had a particular look at and put into the memo, which is, I'm just scrolling through very fast here, the InvestNI new international trade policy, which looks at how there won't be perhaps as much of an emphasis on the classic model that InvestNI has used of attracting FDI as it currently is, which has targeted specific industries and has looked in particular areas, often America, and part of the selling point has been that Northern Ireland is an access point to the EU and the market that conveys and so on. What they're really looking at now more is looking at new markets, the idea of creating more embedded people within those markets, rather than having particularly just an office with representatives there and doing trade missions. It's actually having people in market who provide facilitation for sectors, particularly agri-food, to be able to sell directly into those markets. So it's a different model where it's looking more at export. It's increasingly focusing on bringing companies to export and looking at how that can be done quickly in a post-Brexit situation where it'll be a case of trying to use trade deals that already exist or defaulting where it's practical to World Trade Organization rules, which in some cases are fine and will be okay for exports. That's also in members' packs to have a look at. Committee agreed to facilitate House of Lords EU committee inquiry into trade in goods and non-financial services post-Brexit. The Lords EU committee has a number of subcommittees and they produced five or six Brexit inquiry reports. And this was a particular one that this committee fed into, and we put out a call to key stakeholders to seek their input on a number of questions that had been determined by the EU committee and the Lords. We had a good selection of responses. We had the likes of CBI and I, the IOD, Enterprise and I, and a number of individual companies responded. And they came up with a set of concerns that I just go through just to remind members of what those were. Very similar to the ones we've heard before. Concerns around the unique geographical and political status of Northern Ireland, the land border sharing issue, the need to still maintain access to the single market as far as possible, the administrative burden and potential smuggling if there is a hard border between Northern Ireland and the Republic of Ireland. That was a particular one that was very, very prevalent in a lot of the responses there were. How to continue foreign direct investment with a new proposition outside the EU. How to look at the potential and support the potential for increased intra-UK trade in a Brexit situation, and also how you develop access to new markets or how you push towards new markets. Any potential for continuing to access EU funds. Again, the one we talked about before, the skills gap and access to migrant labour. And that Northern Ireland is the phrase that's been used so many times, a special case and should be treated as such. Those were all common issues to pieces of work we'd seen before. And I basically then, the last bit of the memo was the issues that the committee has raised with the department. Now, a lot of those questions are still pending answer because nobody knows what the situation is yet. A lot of that will only become apparent once Article 50 is triggered prior to the end of March, as is expected. Yeah. But a lot of it focused on how the department will cope with repatriation of policy areas, how they cope with supporting small businesses, micro businesses, and so on, to cope with all these new situations, how they cope with issues around agri-food, etc., etc. There's about 20 questions there. What we also have in the memo is the actions that the committee had agreed at the strategy session in terms of Brexit. We've largely done what the committee set out to do there, a lot of which was communication and information gathering. Mm-hmm. So really what the purpose of this is to seek guidance from the committee as to where they want us to move now in terms of continued work on Brexit. So, Chair, it's a case of seeking members' views on what they'd like us to continue with now.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Chair, or Vice-Chair, I think...
well done, Peter.
It's sort of strange, the Scottish Government talking about solidarity of nations. I thought that was the Union, but maybe I got it wrong along the line somewhere. I think we have to face up to reality, that we are now, because of the current political situation that we find ourselves in, looking at our government in Westminster dealing on our behalf in relation to these issues. So I think, therefore, because of those who have decided to bring the House of Cards down here, they have now ensured that the very thing that they didn't want is that it will be our national government, it will be our Prime Minister, and it will be the Secretary of State for Northern Ireland who will be representing the views of Northern Ireland. So I would suggest that what we should do is that the concerns that we raised with the Minister should be conveyed to the Secretary of State, and that will at least ensure that the Secretary of State, who is Her Majesty's representative in Northern Ireland as part of the United Kingdom, is fully informed as to the concerns that we have had as a committee, not party political, but as a committee in relation to the issues. I have to say, and can I commend the clerk for the information and the way that this has been brought together for us. On a practical suggestion, which might be helpful for if we have ever a committee again, I think would be if we could bring all the Brexit information into one place.
One pack, yeah.
Because what has happened is over a period of months, we have elements in every committee. If we could collate it into a Brexit file, you know.
Just on that point, we have done this as a group of committee clerks. There is a facility. We now just have to work on how we give people access to
yes.
that.
Yes.
It's also something, Chair, that was raised when we met with the Eructus Committee, how we share, because they've also done a huge amount of work on this, and how we share everything together. That's a technical solution we're currently working on.
Yes.
But it will be made available, and I think there's a desire to publish as much as possible too. So all of the research that has been done for committees by our own research services is now available online and can be. I don't think it's stored together because it's generally their research is published according to the committee that
yes.
Sort of. But you can word search it or topic search it. So right. That is probably helpful as well. But we are working on ways to do that. So point made and taken.
Any other comments?
Yes, Chair, can I just add, during our visits, I think we all agree that it was clear that we were getting messages from industry that we were all here in our own constituencies, and it was about that access to labour and about access to single market. And there were pivotal cases for businesses on whether they will remain in business in Northern Ireland, if they will choose to move south or go elsewhere. And I think... Obviously, you're right. You know, at a time when those business people are looking here for governance, there's none.
Mm-hmm.
Now, wherever you sit on the Brexit debate, and my position's clear on that, I think it's shameful that we are offering nothing to those people who are looking to this place for guidance through probably the most significant economic change that will ever face any of us in our lifetime. And we are essentially silenced in this. We have no role to play in helping those people, and that's where we appear to be at. And I would say we have reversed so far in politics over the last few months that we now are looking to the guarantors of the Good Friday Agreement as the lead people in anything politically leading forward here, and that includes any Brexit negotiations. And I think the Dublin government have a large role to step up and navigate in finding a way forward that works for the island of Ireland. And I think it's unfortunate that people did not even feel fit to be here today to discuss, knowing Brexit was on the agenda today, that regardless of how tongue-tied people have become because they've been double-speaking for a long time on this issue, that we at least sent some sort of clear direction to the department and where we would like them to face. And I think I would like those officials in the department to realise and recognise that they have to face south to the Dublin government in every bit as much as they have to speak to Theresa May and Brokenshire and whoever else are players in it. But I do want to place on record my disappointment that people have categorically been failed outright on this issue. Whether they believed in it, whether they thought it was a good idea or a bad idea, they have nobody to drive through this. And I think it needs to go on record.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. Any other comments, Stephen?
Yeah, I share the frustration. I mean, the complexity we have, and obviously Peter is in a slightly invidious position here, that the elephant in the room is that we may not be here next week, so a lot of work may be fairly nugatory over the next week, but I suppose, I mean, keep you busy, Peter, in some shape or form. I don't want to go too far into the wider politics around this, but if we look at the situation around the letter from FM and DFM in August or July, whatever it was, that is, as far as I can see, the starting and end point in terms of any formal position of the executive and, by extension, the various departments. I mean, at this stage, I mean, I think even if we're talking, dare I say, in terms of a legacy issue, I mean, we should be highlighting to the department, which will continue during any interim position, in any event, with a minister through to an election and then thereafter under a permanent secretary. I mean, what we believe are the key issues that do need to be addressed in terms of formulating a position. I mean, I concur that from my discussions with business, I mean, access to labour and skills is actually slightly ahead of access to markets. Now, that may well reflect the existing business and business models as opposed to what will be our future investment capacity, when that may could flip in terms of the different perspective that will come from others. We also need to highlight again, reinforce the point around the energy market on the island. Yeah. The stuff that wasn't actually mentioned in the letter, for example, around some of the funding issues, the continuity of structural funds from our perspective, obviously what's going to happen with the ERDF and the ESF, and some of the relevant discretionary funds, Horizon 2020 being the particular one, how that's going to unfold, and the position to date that everything's fine, that UK government will pick up the tab, doesn't really appreciate the full subtleties around how that process works in practice. So I think if we perhaps you can get something off that essentially lists those as the key issues that we would expect the department to formulate a clear view on, and perhaps even include the view on what is the best orientation for Northern Ireland vis-a-vis both the single market and the customs union.
Gordon?
Thanks, Chair. And I have to say, you know, Stephen's right, there is obviously an elephant in the room here. And I don't know whether we'll even be here next week meeting as a committee. And the first thing that I want to do is just place on record my thanks, Peter, to yourself and to your staff, because I am aware that you've done a significant amount of work. I know all members will join me in that. You know, you've done a significant amount of work, an awful lot of planning for the things that go ahead. And I know a lot of times it seems that we all we need to do is turn up here, but you've done an awful lot of work before every meeting, and we do appreciate that. And I think that, you know, we had the potential to do an awful lot of good work here. And although my position on Brexit may be different from some other people here around the table, I believe, you know, obviously the opportunities that can come from Brexit. I also realise there are challenges, but I don't believe that any of those challenges were insurmountable. And I believe that we could have worked through those. But the political situation that we now find ourselves in has left us in the worst of all worlds. And as the First Minister has already said, at a time when we need the government and the executive to be working, it's not going to be there by the looks of things. And that is a very, very sad and sorry state of affairs. And I don't believe that that is ultimately for the good of people in Northern Ireland. I think that what has happened has happened to serve narrow political interests, not in the greater good of people in Northern Ireland. I understand Sinead is from a different political persuasion than I am, and it'll be no surprise that I don't believe that there should be Dublin, that Dublin has a role here to play in negotiating on behalf of anybody in Northern Ireland. But I do think that it is important that the work that we have done, the concerns that we have raised, the things that we want to see happen are passed on to the Secretary of State, and indeed to the Prime Minister as well, because if we're not going to have this assembly, if we're not going to have an executive to make sure that our voice is heard, we need to make sure that the Prime Minister hears what we say, and that the Secretary of State for Northern Ireland is actually working on our behalf and on behalf of the people right across Northern Ireland. So, and we do have to highlight, it appears that the Sinn Féin members have not turned up to any committees today, and I think that speaks for itself. They, they've gone AWOL, and that's not helping anybody here at all. I think it's a very, very sorry state of affairs. So whatever we're doing next, whatever happens in the next few weeks, I do want to place on record again my thanks to the committee staff for the work that they have done, because I believe we could have achieved an awful lot, and that opportunity has now been taken from us.
Thank you, Gordon. Any other comments? Committee, first of all, I would like to echo the thanks to, and regardless of what happens, first of all, to the team for everything they've done, but also for that particular piece on Brexit this morning. That was excellent expose, and I'm going to keep that because I'm definitely going to use that going forward. I think just surmising what the views around the room, we do need to write about our concerns directly to the department. And I would propose that we do that, but we also info address it to the Secretary of State for Northern Ireland and to the Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade, to Charlie Flanagan, who I know he's taken a keen interest in this. And we'll also do it as an info copy as well. We could also pass it on to the relative Brexit departments in Whitehall. If that's the case, I want to have a proposer.
Sorry, Chair, could I also add on Taoiseach to that? I think at this stage...
I'll go through Charlie Flanagan too, yeah, on Taoiseach, and I'll go through the Secretary of State.
Vice-Chair, can I say we will not be supporting the information going to Charlie Flanagan. He's the Minister of the Department of Foreign Affairs in the Irish Republic. These are issues which first and foremost have to be addressed by Secretary of State, the national government, our government. And I think that we have a working relationship, which we will continue to explore. But I think in terms of the issues which are relevant to this committee, it is not our place to be sending that to Charlie Flanagan. They have no place, even under the terms of the Belfast Agreement, in the internal affairs of Northern Ireland. That will remain the case. And while others today may be having wish lists similar to their counterparts in Sinn Féin about a new dispensation of joint authority, we are UK citizens, we voted as UK citizens, we remain as UK citizens, and whatever the political future is, I am a unionist, part of the United Kingdom, and that is how it will be. So we will not be supporting that too. And I think it's disappointing. The unionists would feel that it has to be an address to the Dublin government, to the Secretary of State for Northern Ireland, to our own national government, and therein it stands.
I think one of the things is the question is that it's an information copy, it's not an action copy. If that's the view of it, I think
information, it is the principle is it goes to the Secretary of State and it goes to the department, it stays in terms of Northern Ireland, and that's where I think it should be.
Chair, could I just add, Brexit is bigger than any one of us, and it's much bigger than this committee or this executive, if there was one. And I think a little bit of humility would not go amiss as we walk out the revolving doors. The baton has been dropped. Now, I don't want this committee to have to leave on party political terms or pointing the finger whether it was Sinn Féin dropped the baton or DUP dropped the baton. The executive has dropped. It's likely that we will not see anything in the next few days to suggest anything different. People of Northern Ireland essentially have no voice on this unless we at least point to guarantors to say, would you at the very least pick up where we have no voice? That is the least we can offer the people that you've turned your back on here today. The very least. And to suggest that it's okay to still, to the last breath, play politics with this and think that it's okay not to involve the Irish government, I think is an insult to the people of Northern Ireland. And I genuinely would appeal to you, think about what you're doing here.
I think, Vice-Chair, it's very disappointing that every time whenever we're having a political discussion, there's comment made about our integrity in terms of arrogance or humility. I'm simply saying, and I have been to Dublin, I have had the discussions, I have no difficulty in terms of that interaction, but what I'm simply saying, Sinead, is the political reality as to where we sit today, tomorrow, and in the future, is that the national government at Westminster will be now, because of the actions of nationalists, will be led, as it was going to be anyway, led by our Prime Minister. What I'm simply saying is that the people of Northern Ireland, for whom we represent, are happy that it will now be, in the light of the political circumstances, the Secretary of State and the British government, who will lead those...
I appreciate and I respect that. And I ask Mervyn to equally respect the people I represent.
And I do.
The people I represent will be looking as much south as they will be looking across to see what Theresa May and colleagues are doing. And I see no problem, I really cannot see, other than plain politics, that copying a legacy letter of the problem to the Southern government should be an insult to anybody.
To be fair, that's not what you're saying. You said earlier on that you think it's important that you're talking about co-guarantors in the South speaking on our behalf and speaking for people in Northern Ireland. You can understand why we would have a problem with that. This isn't just about copying
Yes,
that.
But
you
to
said,
be fair,
essentially saying,
we are at where we are at because of decisions that have been made by your executive government. This is where we are. You may have regrets and you may look back and think you don't like where we are, but we are here. This very possibly could be our last meeting.
Yeah. It will be.
People in Northern Ireland essentially have no voice. And what we are saying as a legacy of this committee, let us at least acknowledge those people that we will be looking to carry forward on behalf of the people where they have no voice, they have no public representative. We are looking to who will be representing. The people I represent will want the Dublin government to have a pivotal role in any way forward on a Brexit campaign.
Thank you, Sinead. I think you made that point. Stephen?
I think we just need to be slightly careful that we end up, this becomes an issue of who gets letters,
Get
letters, as opposed to the substance of that. I tend to agree with Sinead, not necessarily around where a party wants to go in terms of joint authority, but this issue around the implications of Brexit on Northern Ireland is an issue for the Irish government, almost as much as it is for the UK government, because how Brexit unfolds will have implications across the islands, and that's just a reality and a fact, rather than necessarily a political point. That said, can I suggest that rather than us getting bogged down on who gets the letter, we need to focus on the fact that we're doing a letter,
mm-hmm.
and that letter will be communicated. Not necessarily endorsing Mervyn's, shall we say, logic as he reaches the point. I think the better consensual point for us is simply to send it to the department and copy it to the Secretary of State, and perhaps copy it to individual members as well for information, what the individual members do with the letter. Mm. Is there a fair people read between the lines on that one?
And then we can
I think there's that's a proposal on the proposal there. All those who would be in favour, or is a second? All those in favour agree?
Stevens?
Yeah.
So essentially, the letter would be drafted, written to the department, and copied to the Secretary of State. All members receive it, and then members can then direct it as they wish.
We're choosing not to send it to the Irish government, is that one?
The proposal has been to
okay, so we're taking that to a vote. Well, can I put on record, I disagree with
it. How this can be done is if there's an amendment to that, the amendment gets voted on first, as would happen in the chamber. So, Ms. Brandy, are you suggesting that the amendment to Dr. Farrie's proposal would be that it is specifically copied to the
Irish government.
So because that's an amendment offered to the proposal, that needs to be voted on first. So if we can vote on that amendment first.
Okay.
Okay.
So members are in favour.
All those in favour of the amendment?
One.
One member. Members against? Five. And are you voting on this?
No.
So members abstaining? Abstention. Abstention. Okay, so two abstentions. Okay. So then the amendment falls, and therefore the original proposal.
We write to.
Through. So we're writing it to the department, we're copying it to the Secretary of State. It'll go to all individual members, and then members can direct it as they wish.
And with due respect to the committee, I'll put on record that I shall immediately copy it to the Irish government.
Yes, as will the Secretary of State. So, you know, that's the bizarre thing about it. Right, having moved from the issues of Brexit, can we move to matters arising? And the first issue was our comment on page 163 on the ministerial response about the budget. There is no budget. So have we any suggestions and actions going forward?
Sure.
Dr. Farrie.
It was similar light, hopefully not as contentious as the last approach.
Go on.
First of all, I'm not going to get in a waste of energy in terms of reflecting back on the very poor response, but I would think that I think there's more that can be said to us at this stage without going into saying there's a budget process going. There's a lot of things that have happened that we should be privy to, but park that to the side for one moment. The bigger issue we have to contend with is the implications of a collapse of the Assembly on future budget planning. And the default position being that the PermSec of DFP can put in place a budget for 75%.
And then up to.
And then that goes up to 95% or presumably 100% down the line afterwards. Now, in some senses, people say that everything will be fine, everything will be put in place on the far side of the elections or into the spring, and everything will be fine. There are a whole host of subtleties that will be lost in the intervening period. I think it's useful for us writing to the department and highlighting those and seeing if they can produce at least some response or at least even put them on their agenda. The first one is around renewable heat. I appreciate there's a separate issue around when we're going to see what the mitigating plan is going to be. But we need to, first of all, determine in the event of what is going to be a default budget. My working assumption is that the PermSec at DFP will not make any political judgments. They will simply roll forward previous year's budgets. So we have an issue in terms of where the liability for renewable heat is going to lie. Is it a central pressure across all departments, or is it parked as things currently stand in the Department of the Economy? And if it's the latter, then there's a potential issue there of disproportionate impact upon the service areas of the department. There's a second issue, which you'll see towards the end of the Assembly research briefing, which we probably need to have a slightly more clarity around, but I'll put it on the table without necessarily overly stressing at this stage, is the inability to spend accruing resources. So the money comes out of the consolidated fund, but there's also money that's accruing resources that comes in, which could include things like European funding, which may have a bigger impact on some departments, but there are potential risks around the ability to spend ERDF and ESF monies. There's then issues around those organisations that aren't in a contractual relationship with the department, who are therefore treated as essentially discretionary spend, come the 1st of April. That may involve grants going out to the community and voluntary sector, where there's not a formal policy position to fund. So there are some organisations who are not being dependent upon match funding around ESF. It could be left in the lurch. It may be a bigger issue in terms of how things were transferred across to the Department of Communities, but there may be some legacy issues in terms of the department. Those are probably three things at this stage, never mind all the wider strategic planning issues around how budgets are spent that I think we could highlight. There may well be others. Those are just off the top of my head at the moment as we
through. Yeah. Any other comments?
Okay, we go ahead.
Excellent, and do that.
Thank you.
Okay. If we move on to the apprenticeship level, levy, page 166. Can I highlight to the members the department's consultation on the levy closed on the 23rd of December? Could I seek the members' agreement to request an urgent evidence session on the findings of the consultation and the department's intentions regarding the levy moving forward? All those agreed?
Okay.
Agreed. And if you have any other further actions around the apprenticeship levy, I know that we're probably in an issue where we're going to be or where we're not going to be, but this is raising considerable interest, particularly amongst the business community, and it's something we are going to take. We're going to have to take a significant view on going forward. But that's what. If we move to ministerial response on matters pertaining to the NICO, further members to the ministerial response on page 168 regarding the committee's request pertaining to the various issues. Are you content to note the NICO letter at this stage?
Agreed.
Agreed. Invest in I's response on Rapi's report, Belfast to Bahrain. Spare you to the correspondence from Invest in I at page 169 in relation to this information that was requested by the Chair. Anybody, any views on Invest in I's response? Ask the members if you're content to note.
Agreed.
Yeah. And if we send the response on to repeat,
reprieve.
Ministerial response on life and health services. Ministerial response on page 172 regarding the life and health services sector. Bearing in mind this is of considerable interest when we did our visit to Randox, and it's an area within the life sciences sector that most people are interested in. Ask members if you've got any further actions you would wish to suggest on this particular issue.
Mr. Chair, maybe worthwhile if we were able to forward that to Randox.
I think it's very interesting. Yeah. Yeah. Moving on, the Secretary of State of Northern Ireland's response to the Business and Advisory Group, when we were asking who were the members of the Business Advisory Group towards Brexit, on page 174, and it's mentioned doesn't detail the names, but it does detail sort of the organisations, and I think I'd be quite content to note at this stage.
There's no transparency in the NIONA, is there?
Never was. Sorry. Not for the record.
Somebody needs to find out.
Removing to renewable NI, refer members to correspondence renewable NI at page 176, requesting that committee facilitate a meeting of the minister to discuss small-scale generation. They've contacted the minister, but we haven't received a response yet.
Yeah, this is one that had come through the committee earlier. Members will recall we talked about the consultation on this, and they had a number of issues they wanted to address with the department. The department hasn't responded to those yet. So what we're suggesting is that we forward their letter to us, indicating their disappointment with the department, to the department, to make it very clear that they need to be dealt with, and that there is an issue there for them. If members are content, we'll forward that on.
Content. Department for Economy's whistleblowing guidance we asked for. We asked for the Department of Economy's guidance, and that's at page 177. The guidance is available on the department's website, and the committee has also requested a copy of the department's risk register. Are you content to note the guidance at this stage? What's happened to the risk register?
That is in transit.
Yes.
Although there is a
substantial, it actually left?
There is a substantial amount of it is accessible publicly anyway. I think we were really just looking for specifics to this sort of situation. We haven't received that.
Yeah, if we're here next week, could we have an update on where the risk register is? Okay. Committee
We are cheap here about this in transit business.
Yeah, it's, that's what I said. When, has it actually left?
The broadband is
it's
very slow.
It's a new phrase.
So we'll go down to the mail room, shall we? Yeah, right, okay. The committee visit to Dublin. Four members of the committee report on the visit to Dublin is at page 9 of the table papers. Ask the members of your content. Agreement and content with the report.
Mr. Happy to agree that there is a salient point, but I think it was very worthwhile, despite the procedural and political comments that I made earlier in relation to how we conduct our business. It is worthwhile, it is useful, and I particularly think that the discussions that we had with the business organisation was exceptionally useful, and obviously that now is all put in jeopardy in terms of trying to replicate it here with ourselves because of the recent political activity. So whatever the outcome of that, I still think the organisations here will probably want to have that conversation with their counterparts in the Republic on the modalities of the real issues about wheat and corn and all those things, which are the real issues for business.
It wasn't it, have we written thanks and letter of thanks to IBEC?
Yes, that has all gone out. Where we really are with that now is an invitation has issued to the Rutgers Joint Committee on Jobs, Enterprise and Innovation to come up here in February. Obviously, when we know what's happening next week, we will obviously write out to everybody that is in a... where we have events or things planned in terms of briefings and so on. At the minute, everyone is still on standby. The reciprocal dinner for IBEC coming up here, we'd already started to organise as well. I think CBI will probably do that anyway.
Angela.
And I think it'll be just useful, and members may be able to feed into that anyway. We just have to see how that works out, but what we try and do is make sure that there's an awareness of anything that will continue to be organised so the members are able to participate in that. It can't, if there isn't a committee, it can't be a committee thing, but certainly they seem to be quite keen to go ahead with the CBI IBEC, who meet a lot anyway.
Yeah.
Obviously, the reciprocal visit by the Rutgers committee, if there's not a committee here, that won't go ahead, but they obviously are following our situation, and we will communicate directly with them anyway. We will do that with all those sorts of issues, and you'll see when we get to the forward work. There's a lot meant to be happening in January, so we'll deal with all that as we need to. Some things can go ahead because they aren't necessarily just dependent on the committee or members. There's external visitors or so on. But we will yes, we sort all that out.
Okay, thank you. So the briefing paper, Executive Budget 2017-18 funding envelope. Inform the members of the raised paper on the Executive Budget 2017-18. The funding envelope is page 14 of the table papers. Ask the members if they're content to note the paper pending receipt of the forthcoming budget.
Agreed.
Agreed. Item 8, SL1, the Health and Safety First Aid Amendment Regulations Northern Ireland 2017. The papers for this item include the Clerk's Memo on page 183 and the SL1 at page 184 and the Ministerial Correspondence at page 198. The purpose of the statutory rule is to amend Regulation 3-2 of the Health and Safety First Aid Regulations Northern Ireland 1982, SR 1982 number 429, the 1982 regulations, by removing the requirement for the Health and Safety Executive of Northern Ireland to approve training and qualifications for the purpose of first aid at work. The rule is subject to negative resolution and would come into operation in April 2017. Still on?
That will change to a different mechanism if we aren't here, and it will still happen anyway. It'll
okay.
just become a different
yeah.
creature, but the process will continue. So that would
that's the same
probably keep to the time scale,
yeah.
I would have thought.
Advise members that this is the committee's opportunity to consider the policy set out in the SL1, as it's not possible to amend this once the rule has been made and laid out before the Assembly Business Office. Members, are you content with the policy implications of the proposed legislation?
Agreed.
Agreed. Are you content to note the ministerial correspondence on page 198?
Agreed.
Agreed. Agenda item 9, SR 2016/427, the Mines Regulation Northern Ireland 2016. Been back and done this again.
Yeah, this was originally to committee as an SL1 back in June. We'd done a bit of to and fro with the department on it, but essentially members were content at the time with the way the SL1 had worked out.
Yeah. Clark's memo, page 207, and the statute regulation at page 209. Ministerial correspondence on page 302. I'd advise you that this rule is subject to negative resolution. The committee discussed the rule at SL1 stage on the 21st of October 2016, and the members were content with the policy implications set out. The rule will come into operation on the day after the day in which it is affirmed by resolution of the Assembly. Okay. Inform members, the examiner of statutory rules has not raised any issues in relation to the SR in her report. If members are content with the SR, are we content?
Agreed.
Yeah. Okay.
Therefore, that the Committee of the Economy has considered SR 2016 number 427, the Mines Regulations Northern Ireland, and subject to the examiner statute rules report, has no objection to the rule. Agreed?
Agreed.
Agreed. Okay. Move on to item 10, correspondence. First item is the Insolvency Practitioners Recognised Professional Bodies Amendment Order, Northern Ireland 2016. I can refer you to the Department of Correspondence on page 305 from the Department informing the Committee of Proposals to make a statutory rule, the Insolvency Practitioners Recognised Professional Bodies Amendment Order in Northern Ireland 2016. Members, are we content to note at this stage pending receipt of the SL1?
Noted.
Thank you. Correspondence from the Committee for the Executive Office refers members to the correspondence of page 306 from the Committee of the Executive Office highlighting the committee report on the draft programme for government 2016-21. Are we content to note?
Agreed.
Policy Forum for Northern Ireland keynote seminar, Economic Development in Northern Ireland, Key Challenges and Opportunities Post-Brexit. Members who can refer to the correspondence from the Policy Forum for Northern Ireland at page 308. The forum is requesting that a member of the committee chairs the first half of the seminar on the Tuesday, the 25th of April, 2017. And I understand you're not available, Sinead, for that occasion. I think we'll refer that back again closer to the time.
We can sit on that for now.
We can sit in that time. Yeah, thank you. Policy Forum for Northern Ireland. Policy Forum for Northern Ireland keynote seminar, Energy in Northern Ireland. I refer the members' correspondence to page 310, informing the committee the full transcript of the energy seminar held on the 6th of December 2016. I would remind us that the committee has scheduled its own energy discussions event on 25th of January 2017. Hopefully that occurs. And if we're happy to content the note of the transcript for now.
Noted.
Noted.
Thank you.
Invitation from the Law Society Northern Ireland to correspondence from the Law Society, page 312. inviting the committee to a dispute resolution service event.
Great.
So, so Gordon, are you volunteered to go to it then?
I nominate
you, Gordon.
I would need to declare it.
I humbly accept.
if we could advise the committee, if there's any people that are available for attention. There's also on the same day, there's an invitation to attend the Northern Ireland Human Rights Commission for Bar of Northern Ireland, and they have their annual lecture on next Tuesday as well. And then, of course, the Royal Courts of Justice. Again, please advise Peter if anybody's available for that. Consumer Council draft forward work programme for 2017. Can refer to the correspondence on page 315 from the Consumer Council, informing the committee that the draft forward work programme is now open for public consultation. Ask the members are happy to note. Yeah. Notes. Correspondence from an individual regarding closure of tourist attractions over the holiday period. There is a correspondence at page 316, individually highlighting the closure of tourist attractions during a holiday period.
Hello.
Are we content to forward to Tourism NI and for the department for comment?
Mm-hmm. Where did it really appear?
Well, essentially, they went everywhere and nowhere was
shut.
Titanic was closed. They went to a number of places. But it was a public holiday. It was the Monday, the 2nd.
We'll refer it on.
So it was a public holiday.
We'll refer it on.
It's just very unfortunate. Everywhere they tried was closed.
Did they try the goblins?
I would wish, as the acting chair, to put on record that the cafe in the Goblins is excellent and the gift shop is excellent as well.
That's all you have.
Yes, it is.
Sure, we have Hollywood's full of coffee shops.
Walk the coastal path.
Gentlemen and ladies, let's move on. Union Learning Fund, referred to correspondence at page 317 from the Union Learning Works. Peter, do you want to?
This arises because I was doing an access to the assembly talk. We go out and we talk to people about how they communicate with committees, how they can access the assembly and its business through committees. And it was with a number of learning representatives from various trade unions. And they had highlighted this issue of the importance of funding for union trade union learning programmes and so on. Really, essentially what they were asking for, what they wanted the committee to do, was write to the minister recommending that there is funding for these kinds of programmes and workshops and so on, and they enclosed their leaflet of what it is they do.
It is currently funded by the Department for the Economy. I managed to protect our budget up until last May anyway, but they may be slightly wary of just of a cut to the budget funding.
So I think essentially what we're asking is, are our members content to write to the minister supporting the funding for union learning
programmes? Right.
Yep.
Okay,
thank you.
Forward work programme. Peter.
Yes. As members are aware, and as I sort of said earlier on, we have a number of showcases and events that are going on and scheduled for January, including a Colleges NI showcase, an OU showcase, and our own Energy Discussion Forum event. At this point in time, and also an Ofcom launch as well next week, the Ofcom launch, from talking to Ofcom, they can go ahead because they have a lot of external guests coming to that, so there wouldn't be an issue if there weren't members. The others are largely dependent on there being an audience of MLAs, essentially, to make them worthwhile or populate them. So what we're telling stakeholders in a minute is we are continuing to plan ahead. We will be issuing a pack for next week on Friday. So until we are told different officially, we are keeping everybody working towards the forward work programme that we have already outlined, obviously with the caveat that we may need to take things down on a short notice basis. So that's essentially the position where we're continuing to work on the forward work programme.
Just on the forward work programme, in terms of any strategy rules, etc., coming through, is there anything that you have been made aware of so far, Peter, or previously made aware of, that's actually time-specific in terms of implementation, or are they all fairly...
Department hasn't flagged up anything that's effectively so urgent that it needs to be done within the next sort of couple of months' time frame.
You're talking like a bedroom tax type sort of reg. Mm. Say or may not be.
They haven't flagged it up.
Yes, but
We haven't been warned about it.
Yeah.
So
nothing of
that. I suspect in some cases that there isn't a completed piece of legislation that can be shared. We do have a fair idea of what's meant to come, but nothing that the department has said they absolutely need to rush at us. Technically, they could still do that, and if something comes, we could look at agreement by correspondence while the committee is still in existence, but if it isn't on a meeting day. So we will respond.
Chair, can I raise just in terms of a forward work programme? I mean, I'm working on the assumption that it's more likely we'll move back next week, but there's two scenarios. Either there's some sort of deal that seems particularly unlikely, or that we are simply rolling on just in terms of waiting for dissolution, but not that it hasn't actually been exercised. That said, I mean, I think we do need to at least put a marker down. I'm sure we might not get any traction on it, but we should be formally asking for an evidence session on how the department plans to mitigate
the RHI. Yeah.
So at the very least, the request has to be made, and what happens, but we have a duty as a committee to make that request.
That has already gone in. What we're dealing with there is how we run that with the... I appreciate it's a different kettle of fish to what's being done in PAC, because PAC is looking at what happened, and this is mitigating beyond
that. This is not
So the request is there. The request has been with the department since the beginning. It was one of the very early actions that the committee had. If committee want to reiterate that, writing to say to the department, as soon as there is a plan available, the committee wants
we would like to scrutinise a briefing on it.
I can see why you brought it in under forward work programme, but I was maybe thinking it fitted more under any other business, because my thinking was, I know there was talk about that there has been a draft plan, and I just wonder at this stage, is it worth the committee asking for sight of that? Whatever, just to get an idea of what the thinking is, because the one thing is a plug needs to be put on the drip.
Well, we can
essentially
can write with the dual purpose of seeking a briefing for a plan once a plan has been set, but also seeking sight of any drafts that
yes.
exist.
Yeah.
If we could just to formalise this, because I think, Alan, do you want to come in there?
Yeah, I wanted to come in, that's Vice Chair. Just, I was going to wait to any other business.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say.
I mean, we're talking about it now, yeah. So I'll put it out on the table. Just in terms of the outgoing First Minister did make a press statement or a press comment, I think maybe on Monday, that she was planning to bring the mitigation plan to the Economy Committee this week, which was this committee today, and also to the Executive. And I just wondered what the protocols were around that. But can I ask the clerk, was there any indication formally or informally that was even a possibility?
Chair, on Monday I did respond. I sent an email out to all members. Mm-hmm. I'm hopeful that it did get to everybody, because this had been raised with yourself and with the Chair by the media, so we checked directly with the department, and it was referred to the permanent secretary, and we were told no, there was no paper coming to the committee for this meeting today. A plan would have to be agreed at the executive first, so it wouldn't come to us until it had been through the executive, and it hadn't been through the executive, and that's it. So it was a very clear no from the permanent secretary that was purely media extrapolation based on what had been said. They had structured a this week time frame around it, but there was never the department's intention that they would have something this week.
It did seem to come from an opinion piece that the outgoing First Minister had written, as opposed to a reporter misreporting, you know, but I found it quite surprising.
We did go to the department, and that was the clarification they gave us.
I think the other thing is we need to go back to the department, because there's been another, and again I know it's media speculation, I presume it's media speculation, there's been another report that the Economy Minister is due to release his proposals by the end of this week.
I'm assuming there is an executive committee meeting on
tomorrow.
Thursday.
No, it's not in existence. No executive.
Okay, then. Happen. Oh, sorry. Yes.
May I? Let's write.
The Deputy First Minister resigned. See on Monday, Peter, sort of things that will.
Let's write to the department or get in contact with the department and find out what the status is and inform the committee. Because if next week we are sitting next week, which I hope we are, if there is anything available, we should be able in a position to start thinking about it.
I think it really is important that we do see sight of that. I mean, it's just going to disappear out into the ether, but we've heard so much about it. I would like to see it. I'd like to see what the proposals are. But it's all irrelevant because whatever's in it, the legislation's not going to be able to create it or rubber stamped in the meantime. But it just would be nice to see
what it was, what the proposal was.
Okay, well, Chair, we can write. You know, seeking a briefing and asking for any.
So, since we're now formally at AOB,
Just go back on that one. It's not entirely nugatory. There may well be a possibility of UK government actually having to intervene. If there's a live leak, someone has to plug this thing at some point. So, any scrutiny we can provide, even at this 11th hour, is maybe of some limited value. I just wonder as well, Chair, whether we should, in principle, amongst ourselves, be willing to meet. And a special meeting of the committee. So, in the event that something did arrive, even if we're going to be dissolved Monday, even have a meeting on Monday, if the circumstances allow us to have a scrutiny of this, I think in the public interest, we should at the very least make ourselves available to do our job as part of this process.
Chair, can I second that? And I think it's probably incumbent on us as a committee, before anybody exits the door, to find out what levers, if any, are available to us. It is in the public interest to stop the drip of public money before we walk out that door. And anything we as a committee can collectively do to in any way lead to even a reduction in the loss of that money should happen before the end of this week, if possible.
Yeah. Okay, well, we write and see what
any other comments. Sorry, if we see any form of proposal, we should arrange to do that as quickly as possible.
We can put together a committee meeting on that.
Let's do that. And I think we are all agreed that if that information was available, we would like to see that information as soon as possible. Agreed.
Okay.
Any other business?
Roll this into AOB.
Anybody else for AOB? Just a final comment, as I know I'm as the Vice Chair. First of all, I would like to place on record my disappointment that the Chair and the members of another party haven't been at this meeting today, because I think this is a very important meeting for Northern Ireland going forward and some of the key issues. And I'm not just talking about the Brexit issue, I'm also significantly talking about Ofcom and some of the key issues that we're dealing with going forward. The second issue I would like to raise as well is I think so far this committee has done a lot of very valuable work, particularly in areas like the life sciences, higher education, further education, issues around Brexit, energy, and looking at the important things of the Northern Ireland economy going forward. And I think it has done vital work. But I'd also like to set the second record my disappointment with how we've been dealing with the ministry itself. The delay we've had in getting papers coming through and the absolutely sort of torturous work we've actually had to get information coming through as well. But I hope whatever happens post today, that, and I do hope we will be meeting next week, and I do hope we will be meeting to have an opportunity to look at the renewable heat initiative, the method of mitigating the issues to do with sort of the significant cost it's going to be. Regardless of that, as a Vice Chair, I would like to put on record how much I've enjoyed working with you, but all the very positive contribution that you've all made going forward, and above all to the hard work of the clerk and the team for everything you've done as well.
Much appreciated.
And finally, date and time of next meeting. standing fast, getting together to discuss any issues to do with renewable heat. And I think we will make every effort to convene a meeting as quick as possible if that occurs. The next meeting is scheduled for 10 o'clock on Wednesday the 18th of January in here. But ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.